Welcome to the lecture for the course Applied Thermodynamics. We'll continue with the steam generators and today we will see water tube boilers. Myself Sumit Vardia, Assistant Professor, Department of Mechanical Engineering, Sharad Institute of Technology, College of Engineering, etc. Today we will cover the following points: definitions of water tube boilers, types of water tube boilers in that Babcock & Wilcox water tube boiler, Stirling boiler. Again, we are going to see the high pressure boilers, and in that the two boilers which are considered under high pressure boilers, that is Lamont boiler and Loeffler boiler. Actually, what is water tube boilers, that we need to see first. Water tube boilers and fire tube boilers we are compared earlier in the lecture. So water tube boilers are those boilers in which water flows inside the series of tubes and which is surrounded by the flue gases which is coming out from the furnace. So here we can see here the figure in which the heat energy is developed by the combustion of fuel, and that flue gases is passing through the tubes in which water is flowing. So water is enters from one end, flows in upward direction, absorbs the heat from the flue gases and leave from the other end as a steam. And the flue gases which are passing through these tubes are then passes through the smoke box and then it is released to the atmosphere through the chimney, hot gases out. So the basic difference in the water tube and fire tube is, in water tube boilers, water flows inside the tubes which is surrounded with the flue gases, and in fire tube, flue gases are passes through the tubes which is surrounded with the water. That is the basic difference we need to remember. Types of water tube boilers. So here line diagram is shown here. So water tube boilers are categorized into two groups. First one is horizontal straight tube, for example Babcock and Wilcox boiler, and the second category is bent tube. Horizontal straight tube are again classified into longitudinal drum and cross drum. And the cross drum is again categorized into 2 drum, 4 drum, 3 drum. The second category of the water tube boilers, that is bent tube, is categorized into low head 3 drum. So these are the classification of water tube boilers. We will go with the first type of water tube boiler, which is very famous and widely used, that is Babcock and Wilcox water tube boiler. The water tube boilers are used exclusively when pressure above 10 bar and capacity in excess of 7000 kg of steam per hour is required. So we all know that the water tube boilers are famous for high capacity boilers. So if we require higher pressure, we need to go for water tube boilers. Babcock and Wilcox boiler is an example of horizontal straight tube boiler and may be designed for stationary or marine purposes. Babcock and Wilcox boiler, in the figure, it is with the longitudinal drum. Longitudinal drum is there. It consists of a drum connected to a series of front end and rear end header by short riser tubes. To these headers are connected a series of inclined water tubes. These are the inclined water tubes. Of solid drawn mild steel. The angle of inclination of water tube to the horizontal is about 15 degree. So inclination is 15 degree, or maybe sometimes it is more. A handhole is provided in the header in front of each tube for cleaning and inspection of the tubes. A feed valve is provided to fill the drum. Here the feed valve is there to fill up the drum and inclined tubes with water, the level of which is indicated by the water level indicator. So here the water level indicator, which will show you the level of water in the drum. Through the fire door FD, through the fire door, the fuel is supplied to grate where it is burned. So this is grate. Here the fuel is fed into the grate, and which is where it is burned. The hot gases are forced to move upwards between the tubes by baffle plates provided. So here the flue gases will pass through these tubes, in which the baffle plates are provided. These are WTAs, water tubes. So flue gases will pass through these tubes like this. The arrows are shown here. The hot gases are forced to move in upward direction. The water from the drum flows through the inclined tubes via downtake header and goes back into the shell in the form of water and steam via uptake header. So here downtake header and uptake header is there. So water flows from here, from downward to upward, and it converts, it will absorb the heat from the flue gases and converts into steam. So the combination of water steam is flows in upward direction via uptake header. The steam collected in the steam space of the drum. The steam then enters through the anti-priming pipe and flows in the superheated tubes. So this is the superheated tubes, where it is further heated and is finally taken out through the main stop valve and supplied to the engine when needed. At the lowest point of the boiler is provided with the mud collector. Here mud collector is there to remove the mud particles through the blow down cock. The entire boiler except the furnace are hung by means of metallic string or straps or wrought iron girders supported on the pillars. This arrangement enables the drum and the tubes to expand or contract freely. The brickwork around the boiler encloses the furnace and the hot gases. The various mountings used on the boiler, here it is shown. The feed valve, water level indicator, feed valve, safety valve, main stop valve. So these are all pressure gauge. These are all mountings which are used in this boiler. A Babcock Wilcox water tube boiler with cross draw differs from longitudinal drum boiler in a way that how drum is placed with reference to the axis of the water tubes of the boiler. The longitudinal drum restricts the number of tubes that can be connected to one drum circumferentially and limits the capacity of the boiler. In the cross drum, there is no limitation of the number of connecting tubes. The pressure of steam in case of cross drum boiler may be as high as 100 bar and steaming capacity up to 27,000 kg per hour. So that much we can achieve by this water tube boilers. The next boiler is Stirling boiler. Stirling water tube boiler is an example of a bent tube boiler. So that second category in the classification we have seen, vane tube boiler, it is an example of it. So Stirling boiler. The main elements of vent type water tube boiler are essentially a drum, or drums and headers connected by the bent tubes. So these are bent tubes. For large central power stations, these boilers are very popular. They have steaming capacity as high as 50,000 kg per hour and a pressure as high as 60 bar. Here the figure shows a small sized Stirling water tube boiler. It consists of two upper drums, 1 and 2, as a steam drums, and a lower drum known as mud or water drum. Here the second drum is mud or water drum. These are 1 and 2 are steam drums. The steam drums are connected to mud drum by banks of bent tubes. So many bent tubes are attached to the bottom, to the mud drum. The steam and water space of the steam drums are interconnected with each other so that balance of water and steam may be obtained. For carrying out cleaning operation, a manhole is provided at one end of each drum. The feed water from the economizer is delivered to the steam drum 1, which is fitted with the baffle. Here the drum 1, here it is, so which is fitted with the baffle. The baffle deflects the water to move downwards into the drum. The water flows from drum 1 to the mud drum to the rarest water tubes at the back sides. So the mud particles and other impurities will move to the mud drum, where these particles may be deposited. As this drum is not subjected to high temperature, so the impurities may not cause harm to the drum. The blow of cock blows off the impurities. The baffle provided at the mud drums, water baffle B, deflects the pure water to move upward to the drum 1 through the remaining half of the water tubes at the back. So this is again reversing back towards upward direction. The water also flows from it to the drum 2 through the water tubes which are just over the furnace. So they attain a higher temperature than the remaining portion of the boiler, and a major portion of evaporation takes place in these tubes. The steam is taken from the drum 1 through a steam pipe and it then passes through the superheater. Here the superheater tubes, where the steam is superheated. Finally, the steam moves to the stop valve V here, from where it can be supplied for further use. The combustion products ensuing from the grate move in the upward direction and downward direction due to brick wall baffles, and are finally discharged through the chimney into the atmosphere. Fire a brick arc gets incandescent hot and helps in combustion and preventing the chilling of the furnace, where fire door is opened and cold air rushes in. The steam drums and mud drum are supported on the steel beams independent of the brickwork. It is lighter and more flexible than the straight tube boilers, but it is comparatively more difficult to clean and inspect the bent tubes. So that is the disadvantages of these boilers. The next category is the high pressure boilers. In applications where steam is needed at pressure approximately 30 bar and individual boilers are required to raise less than about 30,000 kg of steam per hour, shale boilers are considerably cheaper than the water tube boilers. Above these limits, shale boilers are difficult to transport, if not possible, if not impossible. There are no such limits to water tube boilers. This can be site erected from easily transportable parts, and moreover, the pressure parts are of similar diameter, smaller diameter, and therefore can be thinner. The geometry can be varied to suit a wide range of situations, and the furnace is not limited to the cylindrical form. Therefore, water tube boilers are generally preferred for high pressure and high output, whereas shale boilers for low pressure and low output. The modern high pressure boilers employed for power generation are of around steam capacities 30 to 650 tons per hour and above, with a pressure up to 160 bar and maximum steam temperature of about 540 degrees Celsius. So that capacity of high pressure boilers we are manufacturing here. So next is the unique features of high pressure boilers. What are the unique features of what high pressure boiler? That is categorized into 3 points. First one, method of water circulation. The circulation of water through the boiler may be natural circulation due to density difference or forced circulation. In all modern high pressure boiler plants, the water circulation is maintained with the help of pump, which forces the water through the boiler plant. The use of natural circulation is limited to subcritical boilers due to its limitation. Second category, that is type of tubing. In most of the high pressure boilers, the water circulated through the tubes and their external surfaces are exposed to the flue gases. In water tube boilers, if the flow takes place through one continuous tube, the large pressure drop takes place due to friction. This is considerably reduced by arranging the flow to pass through the parallel system of the tubing. In most of the cases, several sets of tubings are used. This type of arrangement helps to reduce the pressure loss and better control over the quality of steam. So that is the role of type of tubing. Third category is improved method of heating. There are three improved methods of heating may be used to increase the heat transfer. First one is the saving of heat by evaporation of water above critical pressure of the steam. Second, the heating of water can be made by mixing the superheated steam. The mixing phenomenon gives highest heat transfer coefficient. The third one, the overall heat transfer coefficient can be increased by increasing the water velocity inside the tube and increasing the gas velocity above sonic velocity. Okay, so these are the three categories under that high pressure boilers are used. Next is the advantages of high pressure boilers. So what are the advantages of high pressure boilers? In high pressure boilers, pumps are used to maintain forced circulation of water through the tubes of the boiler. This ensures positive circulation of water and increases evaporative capacity of the boiler, and less number of steam drums will be required. So that is the main advantage of high pressure boilers. Second, the heat of combustion is utilized more efficiently by the use of small diameter tube in large number and in multiple circuit also. Third, pressurized combustion is used, which increases rate of firing of fuel, thus increasing the rate of heat release. Next, due to compactness, less floor space is required. That is again the advantage of high pressure boilers. The tendency of scale formation is eliminated due to high velocity of water through the tubes. All the parts are uniformly heated, therefore the danger of overheating is reduced and thermal stress problem is simplified. The differential expansion is reduced due to uniform temperature, and this reduces the possibility of gas and air leakages. Next, the components can be arranged horizontally as high head required for natural circulation is eliminated using, we are using the forced circulation here, so it is eliminated. There is a greater flexibility in the components arrangement. The steam can be raised quickly to meet the variable load requirements without the use of complicated control devices. The efficiency of plant is increased up to 40 to 42% by using high pressure and high temperature steam. A very rapid start from cold is possible if an external supply of power is available. Hence, the boiler can be used for carrying peak loads or standby purposes with hydraulic station. And the last advantage, that is use of high pressure and high temperature steam, is economical. So these are the advantages of high pressure boilers, and we are using the water tube boilers as in high pressure boilers increasing, and we can get the pressure up to 160 bar. Here we are taking the two examples of high pressure boilers. In that, first one is Lamont boiler. This boiler works on forced circulation, and the circulation is maintained by centrifugal pump driven by a steam turbine using steam from the boiler. For emergency, an electrical driven pump is also used. Figure shows the Lamont steam boiler in which the feed water passes through the economizer. Here the economizer is, the feed water supplies through economizer to the drum, from which it is drawn to the circulating pump. The pump delivers the feed water to the tube evaporating section, which in turn sends a mixture of steam and water to the drum. So here steam and water is again transferred to the drum. The steam in the drum is then drawn through the superheater. The superheated steam so obtained is then supplied to the prime mover. Here it is, superheater passes through the superheater and then it is transferred to the prime mover. These boilers have been built to generate of 45 to 50 tons of superheated steam at a pressure of 130 bar and at a temperature of around 500 degrees Celsius. So that is the high pressure boiler, Lamont boiler. Next is a Loeffler boiler. In a Lamont boiler, the major difficulty is the deposition of salt and sediment on the inner surfaces of the water tubes. The deposition reduces the heat transfer and ultimately the generating capacity. This further increases the danger of overheating the tube due to salt deposition, as it has high thermal resistance. This difficulty was solved in the Loeffler boiler by preventing the flow of water into the boiler tubes. This boiler also makes use of forced circulation. Its novel principle is the evaporating of the feed water by means of superheated steam from the superheater. The hard gases from the furnace being primarily used for superheating purposes. So figure shows a diagrammatic view of Loeffler boiler. The high pressure feed pump draws water through the economizer. Here the economizer is there, and deliver it into the evaporating drum. So here delivering is again in the evaporating drum. The steam circulating pump draws saturated steam from the evaporating drum and passes it through the radiant superheater, where steam is heated to the required temperature. From the superheater, about one third of the superheated steam passes to the prime mover, the remaining two thirds passing through the water in the evaporating drum in order to evaporate the feed water. This boiler can carry higher salt concentration than any other type and is more compact than indirectly heated boilers having natural circulation. These qualities fit it for land or sea transport power generation. Loeffler boilers are having a generating capacity of around 100 tons per hour and operating at 140 bar and at a temperature around 500 to 525 degrees Celsius. Okay, so we will stop here. Today we have discussed about the water tube boilers and high pressure boilers, and we will continue with the same chapter, steam generators, in the next lecture. Thank you.